Yes, good morning, dear students. Right, dear students, so far we discussed about the architecture of 8086, right? So please review the architecture of 8086, some few important points which is related to the 8086. Please revise the some important topics which is related to the 8086. CR, inform everyone to join for the class. Inform everyone to join for the class. I need full strength. Unmute your mic.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Inform others to join for the class.
Okay.
Right. So some of the important contents which is related to the 8086, right? Initially we discussed about the architecture and where we discuss about the internal registers of 8086 and its memory capacity, right? So many things that we discussed so far. So the today's content is memory segmentation. So 8086 can able to address the 1 MB RAM, right? So as we discussed in the previous class, 8086 is able to address the 1 MB RAM. So when we see the 1 MB RAM, how the 8086 is going to address the 1 MB RAM? So when we see the memory, every memory location contains a 20-bit address. So 1 MB RAM means every memory location, 10,48,576 memory locations, every memory location requires 20-bit address. So address is 20-bit in size. But when we see the internal registers of 8086, all are 16-bit in size, right? So internal register size is 16-bit, and handling, address handling capacity should be 20-bit. So that is why the 20-bit address of the RAM is divided into two parts, that is the segment base address and offset address. Everyone should remember, today we will be going to discuss about what is the segment base address and what is the offset address, right? So that is very important. So when we see the memory locations, there will be a 10,48,576 memory locations will be there in the 1 MB RAM. Right. So in order to represent each and every memory location, we will be using a 20-bit in address. For example, if you see your roll number, right, 18H51A0452, like that, there will be a sequence, right? So in the same way, in order to represent the every memory location, one specific memory location out of 10,48,576 memory locations, a unique address will be there for each memory location, right? So we will be discussing about that concept today. So the address size will be 20-bit in size, but here, when we see the processor internal registers, all the internal registers are 16-bit in size. There is a logic, you should remember, this is very important class for you people. Once if you learn this concept, then this will be a very much helpful for you people. So once again, I was repeating the contents that in our previous class, we discussed about the features of 8086 and its internal registers, right? So once again, I was revising the previous contents for the information, right? So 8086 is a 16-bit processor. If anybody wanted to note down, they can note down. Yes, 8086 has 8086 is a 16-bit register, 16-bit microprocessor, right? It is a 16-bit microprocessor. Very, very important statement. Sometimes the people will give the wrong answer, like 8-bit or 32-bit or 64-bit. No, 8086 microprocessor. It is a 16-bit microprocessor, right? So, on what basis you are telling that it is a 16-bit microprocessor? 1 minute. Right, on what basis you are telling it is a 16-bit processor, right? Can anyone tell the answer for this? H086 is a 16-bit processor. On what basis? We can tell it is a 16-bit processor. Can anyone answer for this question? Yes, there are 41 members were there, but no one is giving the response. Means then I should call the roll numbers one by one. The people, whoever is, know the answer for this question, please unmute your mic and give the response.
Because it has 16-bit ALU, sir.
Good. Because it has 16-bit ALU. At one particular instant of time, the processor can able to perform the arithmetic and logical operations or data transfer operation over a 16-bit number, right? So here I will convey the details regarding the features of 8086, a brief description over the features of 8086, and after that, I will go for the memory segmentation, right? The first one, 8086, is a 16-bit microprocessor, right? The second one is, tell me one by one. H086 is a 16-bit processor. The H086 can able to address 1 MB RAM. Right, the third one, 8086 of the 8086 is 1 MB RAM, right? So and after that, the third one is, right, the clock frequency range. Clock frequency range from 5 MHz to 10 MHz. Right. So this is another important point from the 8086. Right. So 5 MHz to 10 MHz clock frequency. And one more point, that is the operating voltage is 5 volts, plus 5 volts, right? So the fifth point is the address bus size, that is data bus size of H086 is 16 bit in size. You just remember this. These are very, very important statements from the H086 processor. The one more point, that is the sixth one. Data bus size H086 is 20 bit, right? So these two are very, very important. The data bus is always related to the size of the accumulator and also processor size, right? Whether if the 8086 microprocessor is a 16 bit processor, means,
sir, is the data bus or address bus, sir, 20 bit?
The data bus size is 16 bit, and address bus size is 20 bit, right? Address bus size of 8086 is 20 bit, and data bus size of 8086 is 16 bit in size, right? So there will be a relationship that the size of the data bus and the processor execution capacity, that is 8086 is a 16 bit processor. So 8086 contains the 16 bit arithmetic logic unit, ALU, right? So as per the two parameters, then 8086 has a 16 bit data bus. It is a 16 bit processor. It has a 16 bit ALU. Just see the relationship, how it exists between the size of the processor and also ALU size, and the third one is data bus size. Data bus size is 16 bit in size, right? So another one is address bus size. Address bus size of 8086 is 20 bit in size. So this is also has the relationship that RAM size, RAM is equal to 1 MB RAM, that is equal to 2 power 20. Simply this 20 indicates size of address bus, right? This 20 indicates the size of the address bus, right? So one more statement in the 8086 is it has a two-stage pipelining. Two-stage pipelining is nothing but fetching and execution, right? One is fetching the instruction, and second one is execution. Fetch cycle and execution cycle. Fetch cycle is nothing but reading the instruction from the memory, right? So fetch cycle is nothing but reading the instruction from the memory, where your program will be stored inside the memory, right? So whenever the user required to read the code from the memory, then he uses the fetch cycle. So 8086 just simply it fetches the instruction from the memory and executes the instruction. As per that, we can tell that 8086 has two-stage pipelining. That is, one is the fetch cycle, the time required to fetch an instruction, and another one is the time required to execute the same instruction, right? Both together, it is called as two-stage pipelining. So in the process of fetching and execution, is there any internal registers to store the opcode inside the 8086? Can anyone tell the answer for this? Is there any register to store the opcode inside the 8086? 4B2, can you unmute your mic? 4B2. Are you there? If you are not able to give the answer, then simply I will remove you. You are unable to What you are doing?
Sir, I'm having some internet issues, sir.
Internet issue now?
Yes, sir. It's all, sir.
Don't tell bloody reason in the class. Everyone says that internet issue. Now, is it resolved immediately?
Yes, sir.
Don't know how to be in the class. You know what is happening in the background. If you are not able to tell the answer, just tell the I don't know, sir. Logging in and doing your own work means what is the meaning? And telling the bloody reason that internet issue, everyone. If you are unable to tell the answer, simply you tell me the reason that I don't know, no idea, sir. Simply you can give that answer. That is enough. I'm not expecting the exact answer from you. I want the activeness in the class. Right. So here in the process of fetching and execution, the 8086 has an instruction stream byte queue. The size of the instruction stream byte queue is 6 bytes. It has 6 byte instruction queue. 8086 has 6-byte instruction queue, right? So with the help of 6-byte instruction queue, we can store the code inside the 8086, right? So I already shown that in the block diagram. Just a minute. I will show the 6-byte instruction queue in the 8086. Just see, this is the 6-byte instruction queue, right? It works on the principle of first in, first out. This 6-byte instruction queue, this is meant for the instruction. We can able to store the 6 bytes of the instruction in this queue, right? So it works on the principle of first in, first out, FIFO, right? So what is the necessity of using this instruction stream byte queue? Can anyone tell the answer for this?
Sir. Hello, sir. I'm audible,
yeah.
Sir.
Yeah. Can you tell the advantages of RAM? Why we are using RAM? At least one point. Shall I expect?
Yes, sir. The instruction queue is used because it allows us pipelining, sir. It leads to pipelining. When we already take a instruction from the instruction queue and execute in the execution part, in the meanwhile, it can fetch another instruction, sir.
Very good. Yes. Right. Meanwhile, we can fetch the second instruction, right? Thank you. That is the concept that we are using. So main advantage of RAM is accessing the multiple instructions, right? Two or three at a time. It is possible. So in order to speed up the process, simply what we say is in order to speed up the process or in order to increase the execution speed, we will be using the RAM, right? So that we already discussed the about the what is the advantage of the RAM, why we are using the RAM in between the ROM and in between the processor, right? Even in between the ROM and processor, there will be a RAM, right? Even in between the RAM and processor, there will be a cache memory. Just see, in between the cache memory and the processor, processor is fixed one, but memory it is changing, you just see. So the ROM will be very far away from the processor. When it comes to the RAM, the size decreases and it is somewhat close to the processor. The second one, right? Next one is cache memory, somewhat closer to the processor, right? The left side, if you think it is a processor, then it will be very close to the processor, and also cache memory size will be less. So the RAM will be connected to the cache memory, and the cache memory will be connected to the internal memory of the 8086 or some other processor. Just see how the memory size, initially ROM size will be high, after that RAM size decreases, next cache memory size decreases, and after that internal memory of the processor decreases, right? It's like this. ROM size will be always high, ROM size. RAM size decreases, comparing with the ROM in the system, the RAM size somewhat less, right? After that, cache memory comes into the picture. Next, after the cache memory, next one is internal memory of the processor. So memory communication takes place like this. Directly, processor cannot communicate with the ROM or RAM directly. There will be some other helping devices will exist in between these memories. It is called cache memory. It is called internal memory of the processor, right? It is also called a system bus. In between, to make the communication between these memories, we will be using the system bus, right? So system bus is used to transfer the data from one device to the another device. For example, processor, from processor to I/O devices, right? So from processor to memory, we can use the system bus. System bus plays very important role to transfer the data or code from the processor to memory or processor to I/O devices, right? So this is the thing that I want to tell some points about the 8086. Now I will tell the one minute. Yes. Yeah, all of you, please see this. I may ask the question in between, right? Any question, you should tell the answer. This is very important. As I am telling you, dear students, if you concentrate in the class, if you give the response, right, either if you are unable to unmute your mic, you can chat through the chat box, right? But the thing is, you must be in active state in this class. Otherwise, you may lose something in the sixth sem. There is no doubt about it. Because I have seen so many students. So as per my knowledge in this subject, I am conveying you that you should ask the question at least in between. So out of 60 members, no one is asking the question means what it says. The meaning is, are you understanding everything, all the points? If I put a question, no one will give the answer except one or two members. Right. So memory segmentation. So memory segmentation means what? Dividing the memory into some equal parts. Dividing the memory into some equal parts is nothing but memory segmentation. Now let us see why to give the address to the processor, right? So that's very important thing that we should take care we should think about the one particular thing, right? So why to give the address to the every memory location? Can anyone tell the answer for this? What is the necessity of giving the address to the each and every memory location? So now let me take the example, one small example. Right. This is a 2-byte RAM. You just take 2 bytes. The capacity is 2 bytes. Byte is nothing but how many bits? Can anyone tell the answer for this? Byte is nothing but how many bits?
Group of 8 bits.
Yes, can you repeat?
Group of 8 bits, sir.
Yeah, group of 8 bits is called byte, right? So here we have a data. The data's it is in the form of binary 0 1 0 0 1 0 0 0. Can you convert the same in hexadecimal and tell me the answer for this, for the first one and for the second one? All ones. What will be the hexadecimal equivalent for this? What is the hexadecimal equivalent for this? E3. E3. Just see how the people they are coming to the class. 4E3. Unmute your mic.
Sir.
What you are doing?
Answer.
Why you are not able to unmute your mic? Are you there in the class or somewhere?
Yes, I'm there in the class only.
What I am asking?
What is the hexadecimal of this?
Can you give the answer for this? M2.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Can you give the answer for this? What is the hexadecimal equivalent of this? The first one, all ones were there.
48.
48. First one 48. Okay, good. Second one?
8421, sir.
Second one, 8421. No. What 8421, 8421?
Yes, sir.
M2, unmute your mic. 95, yeah? 95, unmute your mic.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What is the hexadecimal equivalent of this? Such a kind of atmosphere will be there in our class. There will be a much difference between the TR1 and TR2. Right. So two memory locations, FFH. Right. These fellows, you, if you are sleeping, means then no one will help you. Right. But one thing, the people, whoever is unmuting the mic and whoever is responding, I am noting down the everything. Right. It reflects you later. You don't ask me later why the something is happened like this, something is happened like that. You don't compare with the others later. Right. So in order to identify these two memory locations, each memory location size is 8 bits. Right. So 8 bits we can store inside this. So hexadecimal equivalent is FF for the first one. Next one is 48. You know very well about this. If you are unable to tell the hexadecimal equivalent for this means, then you never pass in this subject. There is no doubt about it. If you don't know about the binary numbers, then no one will help you. Right. So you just see here, at least you learn now. Binary numbering system, at least learn just numbering system, that's all. After a small 10th class students, they were telling about these things. So the thing here, I am specifying the address for each and every one. For the first one is it is 0, for the second one is it is 1. So if I want to call the number 48, right, the number, right, which is stored in the memory. So this is a memory. If I want to call the 48, I should use the address 1, right? For example, if I want to call the data, that is FF from the memory, I should use the address 0 by using address bus, right? The processor will tell to the convey that user, initially user will give the instruction like, Mr. Processor, please get the data which is available in address 0. If I say, then immediately it gets the FF data from the memory. For example, if user gives the instruction like, Mr. Processor gets the data which is available in address that is 1, if I say, then immediately it carries the data 48. So depending upon the address, then processor gets the data from the memory, right? So you should give the address in the coding, that is important, in order to fetch the data or in order to fetch the opcode from the memory, you know, in order to read anything from the memory, then you should give the address, right? You should give the address and you can catch the opcode or data. Without giving the address, it is not possible to catch the address or opcode or data. Yes, sometimes addresses also will be there inside the memory, RAM or memory, right? So once if you throw the address, then only it is possible to catch the data or opcode or address from the memory. So in memory, data will be available, address will be available, opcode also will be available, right? For example, the size is increased to the two more locations. Next two numbers are 22H, 44H. I want to call the 44. What the address I should give? I want to call the 44 from the memory. What the address I should give to the 22H and 44H? How to give the addressing? Can anyone tell for answer for this? Please unmute your mic. This is beneficial for the sake of you.
Zero one zero 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 one zero zero.
Yes, good. But the thing comes like this, right? Please see this. 0001. Next, 1011. We just see how the address logically it is related. So this is a physical address. It is a physical address of the memory. Physically, the original address, it is in the form of binary. Not, it is not a decimal number. It is not a hexadecimal number. I was writing the address. It is in the form of binary. It is a binary number, right? Whatever you are seeing here, it is the binary number. Just see. So, okay. If I want to call the 44 from the memory, then I should give the address 11, right? If I give the 11 to the RAM, then RAM will give the 44 to me, right? For example, if I throw the 10 to the RAM, then RAM will give the data 22, right? So I was increasing the address, I was increasing the memory capacity to the 4 more memory locations. Who has given the answer now? Can you tell your roll number?
4F1, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Right. Now I was increasing 4 more memory locations. You should tell the answer. Then how to address now? How to give the address bits? So in this, the next is 11, data in hexadecimal. After that, 33H. After that, 69H. After that, 66H. This is the data which is there in the memory. Right. Now, I want to give the address to these data. How? Can anyone tell the answer for this? Four not seven.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. I want answer. Unmute your mic and tell me the answer. How to give the address here? Please mute your mic. G3.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, how to give the address for these numbers 66, 69, 33?
Address.
Yeah. Are you listening the class?
Yes, sir.
Then? Any other?
So 100, 101, 110, and 111.
Very good.